Seeing the problem as just one is tremendous leverage. Tremendous leverage. So the spiritual path is just you realizing the leverage you have. Gradually realize, oh, I have this, I have more, I have more, and I have more, and I have more leverage. And then you say, huh, maybe I'm not as stuck as I thought I was. Now the ego's insanity and lies seem to be leveraged too. But it's leveraged to stay away from the continuity problem. Stay away from it, not to resolve it. So it's you might call it a fake leverage, where you simply, it's kind of like there's like a you're on a road and there's an obstruction on the road, and one way to go about it is you try to pry the boulder. Let's say there's boulders on the road, and you try to find a way to leverage, so you got enough leverage to roll the boulders away, right? And so you're working on all sorts of, how do I get the leverage to move that heavy boulder, really big, heavy boulder? We can't seem to budge it. And the way of the ego is to roll more boulders down. And so it blocks the road to such an extent the ego will say, look at that road, look how blocked it is. There's no way you can ever get through there, so don't even try. It's stupid to even try. That's the ego's way. Making it so bad that you think it's worthless to even try. And then the ego says, well, okay, just give up. Just give up any thought of ever going home, and then you won't have any more continuity problem. But how can you give up the inclination, the attraction to return to reality, as it were, to wake up from this dream of death? How can you get rid of that? Can you? You cannot. You absolutely cannot. So the ego's way is fundamentally flawed from the very beginning. Entirely flawed. Its whole premise is wrong. It wants you to give up even thinking that you can, going home is something you even want, and give up even any thoughts of home. What home? This is home. World is home. You know, that this, the ego wants you to say, this world is home. I know there's nothing else other than this. This is it. That's what the ego wants, and to get you to give up any, again, inner desire, feeling, attraction, like realization, hey, I want something better, this isn't right, this is not my home, you know. I want you to give up and say, it's impossible, I can never go home, so there is no home. That's what it wants for you. So it will keep piling more and more obstructions, depriving you of more and more leverage, making you feel more and more helpless, like you have no leverage at all of the situation. That's its goal. In other words, to dumb you down or to strip you of all leverage. To bind you, to straitjacket you, as it were. To put you in such an incredible straitjacket, and then you're in a straitjacket, and then there's a straitjacket over the straitjacket, and another one over that, and another one over that, and that, and that, and that, and just endlessly straitjacketing you, so you feel you're just in an infinite straitjacket, straitjackets. So you just give up altogether. Say, I have no possibility, no hope, completely hopeless. That's what his ego is trying to do, make you feel completely hopeless. And of course, the world structure, the bureaucracy, the way the world is going, is in that direction, to break your hope that you can ever change, truly change your direction. No hope of any change whatsoever is the way the world is going. That you cannot truly change your outlook. No hope of ever changing your outlook. And therefore, you'll have some vast epiphany of giving up, that you know it's not possible. Now, surrendering the world is totally different than giving up any hope of being able to surrender the world. It is very different. We can surrender the world. We can turn the entire world over to the Holy Spirit. All time. Turn time itself over to the Holy Spirit. All of it. Not even keep 1 second for yourself. That's why you can do it right now. That's different. That's different. That's saying, I have the remedy right here. So, whereas the ego says, you can't do that. There's no hope of ever being able to turn over time to anything. You're stuck. You're stuck forever. So, but this can all be seen through. Now, it may seem it's impossible. I'll tell you why it's possible. Let's say you're on this road, and the road goes on for millions of miles, just a straight road, just millions of miles, and you say, oh my gosh, I'm going to be on this road forever, traveling down this road. How can I ever get to the end of this road? It's impossible. Are you kidding? It's take too long. So you're going along saying, ah, it's just futile, it's just terrible. And then someone tells you, hey, just get rid of the road. Hand the road over to the Holy Spirit. You don't need the road. So you don't even need to go down the road. Hand the road, let the Holy Spirit travel down that road for you. You don't have to travel down the road. Let the Holy Spirit travel down the endless road of time, or infinite road of time, as it were. Let it deal with this road. You don't have to. And then you say, oh, wow, it doesn't take a long time. I can be free right now if I do that. So when the situation seems impossible, you just say, give this sort of so-called impossible over to the Holy Spirit, meaning the road of time, which seems to stretch on forever. Let the Holy Spirit travel down that road. Now, how can the Holy Spirit, why? Because the Holy Spirit was created to collapse time. So the Holy Spirit's never trapped in time. It never feels, oh my gosh, there's a million miles down that road or a trillion miles down that road. The Holy Spirit says, it's no problem. It's the same as 1 mile or no miles, trillion miles, all the same to the Holy Spirit. So give that trillion mile road to the Holy Spirit and you don't have it anymore. You don't have to go down that road at all. So this feeling of impossibility and trapped, you can get rid of it like that. That's leverage. That's called leverage. The Holy Spirit will show you why that is so. So you may look at your situation and say, it's going to take me forever to get free. Forever in a day, almost. And the Holy Spirit will help you see, oh no, I can just turn the entire forever over to the Holy Spirit right now, right this very instant, and I'm free. You know, the continuity issue will be resolved for me. So it doesn't take you as long as you think it will take you. Not at all. Because the leverage is to get you to the point where you turn time over to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit returns time to you in a certain way. Let it do its thing. I'll have to clarify that exactly. But the basic issues are the same. So I'm still letting this, you know, marinate what I've seen today. I don't want to try and force, you know, try to explain it too much. But you're not as stuck as you think you are. Even if you're on a road that is endless, almost endless, road of time, you think there's no way to get off it. You're not stuck. You see somebody else and they're not on any road at all. And you say, wait a minute, how did you finish this road? How long have you been on the road? And I said, no, not long at all. I realized I don't need any road. I gave my road to the Holy Spirit. It's traveling down the road for me now. Because I know when everybody turns the road over to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit has all time, then when we don't need that anymore, we don't need even perception anymore, it will collapse all this endless time, per se, instantly. So it is not trapped. We think, oh, if we give all the time to the Holy Spirit, it'll be completely trapped. No, it's not trapped at all. The Holy Spirit can show us everything as if everything has had infinite amount of time to become lovely. And it can show it right now. But it's still a hallucination. But it still has a feeling of time to it, actually. So there are ways. We will find out more about that in the future. main thing is to be reassured that in no way are you as stuck as you believe yourself to be stuck. In no way. Even though it looks that way. In other words, you look down the road and you say it is. The road seems to go on just beyond anything I can comprehend. So it'll take me too long. I might as well just give up any hope, etc. Even though that's what you're seeing, in your reason will tell you, no, I can give the whole road away at some point. So I'm not really stuck. It's not going to take me that long. It absolutely won't take you that long. But the clarity that comes, that's coming from me at this point, is very profound, actually, and it's probably too much to try to explain, because it brings one right to the point of diving in, as it were, and that's a little more than can be handled, really. In most circumstances, that's for sure. It just seems like two can't fit it together, as it were. So the more important issue is the facts that you really can't get unstuck. That all our stuckness is simply a reflection of our own fear of the continuity issue, all of it. And that when you see this and you work through the continuity, you realize with the Holy Spirit's the resolution to it. Again, the whole difficulty of all these objections and defenses, etc., they become much, much less difficult. So that's what you're aiming for, is the degree of difficulty gets way less. And something that you thought there's no way you could ever see through this one, you suddenly realize, oh my gosh, I can dismiss this easily. I have complete leverage over it, total leverage over this. What seemed to be something that may have held you captive forever, you now realize you have complete leverage over it. And it's a piece of cake. So that's the situation I'm in right now, is I've realized that I have leverage over all this entirely. But so the point for me now is simply to accept it, dwell on it a little bit, accept it, let it sink in. Just keep on going, keep on working at it. It's a question of using the leverage is what it is. We can see it, then we have to use it at some point. Otherwise, it's meaningless. Leverage is meaningless unless we use it. Otherwise, what's the content of the meaning at all? There's none. Now, we have a world full of people who are following the ego's leverage of no hope, anti-leverage, as it were, to try to and divest us of any hope we can truly change our outlook. And they also understand that they're pushing things. They don't let any crisis go to waste, as it were. Like here's an opportunity they see to to double down on hopelessness. But I can tell you that the answer is something quite different than what the world is aware of at this point. Quite different, actually. But it's certainly along the lines of what we've spoken about in all the videos here. It is certainly along that, in that direction. But getting it more in focus, you see, That fits perfectly. Here's a question. If all of us are going to be free of misery, suffering, death, and all of this training program, if eventually we're all going to drop it and we're going to realize it was all completely futile from the very beginning, why can't we see everyone as if they've already succeeded? Exactly why should we not see it that way? If they've already succeeded in dropping it. As if they, because they're going to, if it's a fait accompli, what's the point in seeing that everyone floundering? Why? So these are the type of questions I ask myself in the day. I just pose this question to myself, like, that's an odd thing that we need to, do we really need to keep seeing each other as struggling with all this stuff? If we're going, guaranteed we will succeed, and we'll realize that all this is just completely unnecessary, this whole everything, and we're going to be in this totally blessed condition, why don't we see it now? And that's just a rhetorical question, because there is no reason not to see it now. But at least posing the question to yourself, it means you get the chance to just say, no, wait a minute, maybe there is no good reason not to see it now. We don't need to see each other floundering. It's kind of like someone who we're all going to be, all going to fly, and why should we watch ourselves struggle trying to crawl or walk and stumbling along? You know, why? Because it's not something that walking, it leads to flying at all. It's actually walking is denial that we can fly. So why pay attention to the denial? Why see everyone as being earthbound, as it were, bound to? Why see everyone as earthbound? Why see anything as earthbound? Why see anything as fleshbound? Why not see everything as spiritualized entirely? That's how it's going to be. And there's no process in getting there except to realize that there is no process in getting there, because everything is just a continuity fear, and therefore a refusal to basically an insistence that we can't get there. That's all that's still going on. There's nothing else going on. Everything is just a continuity, just our reflected fear. And since we're going to drop that fear, everyone, at some point, why not see that it is already is accomplished? So this is a profound question to ask, very profound. Why not see the world as entirely spiritualized? Everything. Without any problem at all, devoid of problems. Completely spiritualized. Already having attained the goal. Because it's not the feel better. So we have things backwards. The ego keeps telling us it's the path, it's the process, it's, that's what's important, not the goal. That's totally false. It's only the goal that matters. And we're all guaranteed to reach that goal. The Holy Spirit guarantees it will bring each one of us to that goal. So we all of us are going to succeed. There will be no failure whatsoever, none. So why see any of this pretense of failure? It's totally bogus. What purpose or meaning does it have to see what you think is failure of anything? What purpose does it serve? Exactly what purpose does it serve? Only the continuity issue of trying to avoid the continuity issue. Nothing else. Doesn't serve any other purpose whatsoever. So why not see a sacred world? Everything already sacred. Completely. Completely spiritualized. Again, all perception is hallucination. So it's all completely unreal anyway. So why not see that which is totally unreal in a way that solves the continuity problem for us? Why not? We're all going to do this anyway, so why not do it now? So ultimately, the leverage brings you back to why not do it now? Why not do it right now? If we're going to give all time to the Holy Spirit, we don't need to even keep a second of it. And if we don't need to keep a second of time, why not? You know, why not do it now? If we're not going to hold on to any time for ourselves, give it all, then why don't we give it all now, right now? Why wait? You know, the Holy Spirit doesn't need any help with time, so we don't need to like say, well, let me hold on to a couple more years so I can help you out. It doesn't need any help. It's not going to help anything. So you bring more and more, you bring it and say, why not see it now? Why not see it now? Exactly why? Exactly why should we not see it now? You know, what is the reasoning for that? And you look and you don't see any. You don't see any reasoning behind it. It's like devoid of reasoning. You know, the objections, there aren't any real objections to it. And so you kind of need to some time to kind of chew on that, to look at it and say, huh, wow, I can't find any reason not to. You know, there's no real objections at all there. In other words, if we take a trillion years to finally drop time and let the Holy Spirit present its perception of everything to us, as it were, if we take a trillion years to do something like that, but we're guaranteed that we're going to do it, just a matter of when, but we're guaranteed, then why not just collapse all the time, the trillion years, and see it now? No difference. You see the same thing. Again, we're saved by grace entirely, so it's not a matter of works. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to do anything to earn it. So these kind of considerations arise, and you're able to just kind of look at them. You know, you don't have to solve it right this instant. You know, you say, oh, well, but you can look at it and say, huh, very interesting. It seems as though I'm just wasting time, actually. And I'm wasting time. Why? Fear of the continuity issue. The Holy Spirit, seeing everything as sacred, solves the continuity issue, actually. I call lovely loveliness is this completely non-flesh-based sacredness, spiritualized. Everything is spiritualized, meaning not flesh. You don't have to see everything as flesh. You don't have to. That's only the training exercise to try to teach yourself how to die. But if you can't, if you know you can't teach yourself how to die, why do you need to see everything as flesh? Why? It's just a hallucination anyway. Why not just see it as all sacred? That's a hallucination too. Why not see it as having this just imperishable loveliness to it? A loveliness that still seems time-based, yet time has become so expanded that the loveliness everything has will take like forever to fade. You might look at it that way. It'll take forever for it to fade. And time is so vast that we can't see any trace of it fading whatsoever. No matter how long we look at it, we just can't see any trace of the loveliness fading at all. And yet we still have this sense of continuity, like, well, it still feels like it's still in time, as it were. See, the Holy Spirit can expand time infinitely. So if you take something like and make it like flawless, as it were, this is the blueprint for something, like a tree, it's like the perfect blueprint of a tree, and say, okay, yeah, this is in time, and time eventually erodes, etc. However, for this tree, the amount of time is infinite. Infinite. So this tree will appear uneroded and flawless for impossible to say how long. So we could look at it for a trillion years and it wouldn't change at all, because it has an infinite amount of time to erode and die. So the Holy Spirit can use time that way on our behalf like that. Because it can collapse all time instantly. So it can literally apply, you know, quadrillion zillion to the zillionth zillion zillionth exponential double, you know, exponential power of time, such that everything can appear to be like immaculate, untouched by time, even though it's still set in time. So everything can appear to us to be completely untouched by time. Right now, the Holy Spirit has that capacity. And it's completely unfazed by that. For us, adding time like this is like, freaks us out. No, Holy Spirit can do that. Because it can literally collapse infinite time instantly. Instantly. I've seen that. I've seen the leverage it has instantly. So it can do that. So if you could see everything as if it were going to be here as it is for just unquantifiable amount of time, it would give you this feeling, a deep feeling of relief from time, as it were, and from definitions, from death, from all of that, even though you have all these familiar objects around you, etc. Amazing, right? This is the secret. The Holy Spirit's use of time is the secret to salvation. And thanks to A Course in Miracles and Jesus for being able to point this out. So we think the Holy Spirit, well, at least this is how I see it. We think of it collapsing time, making less and less of time, but that frightens us. Actually, the way is more time. In fact, infinite, endless, unquantifiable time, such that, again, any process that could be taking place could seem to be not even taking place at all. It's so incredibly slow. In so slow, perception can't even see it at all. Yeah. But we still have a sense that it, you know, it theoretically is there. It's just that we can't see it at all. And so that maintains a sense of continuity, and but yet we feel, it's so lovely. It's like as if there's no death or process at all taking place. And then that enables us to set the hallucination down of perception and definition. And we don't worry, have to worry about the Holy Spirit having all this time on its hands, because it could collapse it all instantly. So, this is like super, super great gospel, good news, super great good news. Sort of like the secret to understanding what we have, what is possible for us. And we have the capability now to talk about it, which is tremendous, actually. Just the ability to explain it like this, you know, is just a massive breakthrough. You don't realize what a, you know, we don't realize what a breakthrough this is, actually. That's the effort of, like, the day, and all day long taping on an MP3 recorder as I drive, constantly trying as best I can to clarify, you know, all during the day, big push for 8 hours, and then another push, you know, going after 3 o'clock. The day's like divided from 8 o'clock to 3 o'clock. That's like 7 hours, and then from 3 to 10, that's another 7 hours. So we're pushing towards the end of the second part of the day. So, you know, make a big push first 8 hours of the first 7 hours of the day, and then make another big push the next 7 hours of the day, and just keep doing that. Keep doing that. Then you're able to talk about these things like this and have a you know, monumental breakthrough like this. That's the result of it. I didn't expect I would have this breakthrough. Actually, I did not. I didn't think it was possible. I thought, no, not yet. But wow, this is a completely revolutionary way of looking at it. And this is not something I read directly, because it, no, but it to me it makes sense, actually. It really does add up. So we can accept that perception of everything. We can accept that perception. So in other words, anything that we see has this almost like a timeless quality, but it's still in time, and yet it's all the processes are infinitely slowed down as far as decay. So everything seems, you know, so fresh and clear and present to us. And even our own perception of it, that too can still be time-based and therefore process-based, yet has infinite amount of time, endless quantities of time, so it also seems like it's immaculate and flawless. That is very possible too. And again, we can abide in that, you know, a trillion years, and it wouldn't seem as if anything has changed, because there's endless quantities of time. The Holy Spirit can just continuously expand time. For however long we take to get used to this, it will just keep expanding time to such extent that no process seems to be taking place at all. Everything seems to be immaculate. And in doing it in this way, it all seems okay to us, all seems kosher to us, because the continuity issue is addressed properly like that. So, we are in a very good place, actually, with this information coming out. Thanks to the Holy Spirit, thanks to Jesus, thanks to A Course in Miracles, thanks to Ananda My Ma. This breakthrough has been possible. And I told you August is the month of breakthrough, so I've looked at it that way. And, you know, I'm just going for it. Just like on the exercise bike, I decided, hey, I'm going to do, you know, 20 minutes, try to do it twice a day, at least once a day, twice a day if I can, and just really, really go for it, and just see if I can't, you know, get a little better shape. Might as well just do it, so. And whatever comes of it, you know, just make the effort. Just make the effort and see, you know, don't worry about what comes of it. Just make the effort and just have faith that, you know, something, it'll be worth it. So we don't even need to have anything look like flesh. But we don't have to drop the idea of flesh or any of that stuff. It's just we can say, well, eventually all this spiritualized, what we're seeing, will become flesh. But, you know, the quantity of time is so much, there's no way we can even catch the faintest perception of that taking place at all. And yet we can still say, well, you know, that is still, you know, it's still time-based, process-based to us. We still say, well, it still feels that this is what can happen. But it's still a dream, in other words. You say, oh, this is still a dream. We're still dreaming. And yet, now the dream is such that we can see everything completely spiritualized and solve the continuity problem, because we'll say, wait a minute, this is very similar to reality. You know, that's amazing what the Holy Spirit can do. So it can change our perception without denying this perception we have now. It's just that's going to come later as a result of gradually process of erosion. Except how much later? Well, endless quantity of time before we ever get to that, you see. So it appears to us perceptually as if we're not getting there at all. But it hasn't yet been, you know, we cannot pick it up. But ideationally, we can still say, well, okay, it's theoretically that it's going to happen. It just, we can't see any trace of it happening. No, none. And then that then reminds us of reality, even though we're still, you know, in a hypothetical scenario, hallucination, as it were. So. And that addresses, that feels very right to us, that we're not being attacked, that we're not being forced, that we're just, God gave a great remedy for the situation. Instead of trying to deprive us of time, God gave us infinite time, as it were. There are limitless quantities of it. I won't say endless, but limitless quantities of it. The Holy Spirit is able to expand time in a limitless way without ever it becoming too much for the Holy Spirit at all. Be able to like collapse it like that, all of it. Because quantity is meaningless to the Holy Spirit. It sees it all as just one. No differences whatsoever. So an instant or limitless quantities of time is all the same. It's all the same. Because the Holy Spirit knows nothing is taking place in time whatsoever. Nothing meaningless whatsoever. It's just a concept. It's just a feeble whim, you know. So, now, it is able to deal with this without the slightest trouble. So, we are in a very good place right now, as a matter of fact. Really getting in good spiritual shape, which is what we need to do, is get in spiritual shape. Just hearing this stuff in your mind is saying, well, maybe there is a, so maybe there is a way. Maybe we are not, you know, in such a terrible situation, factually. Maybe the Holy Spirit really can liberate us from this situation we're in by expanding the time so much that, you know, that could have, theoretically, that could have, you know, miraculous effect on our lives. On anyone who asks for that, it can have a miraculous effect on our lives. So, look forward to that. That is definitely right in focus right now. So nice evening. Very cool day today. The weather is so strange. It's hard to describe. It's like living in just an exceedingly crisp and cool, feeble kind of day in the middle of summer. Very different. Never experienced this kind of weather before here. No way. It's kind of nice. It's kind of nice, actually. Yeah. Very gentle, kind of. You expect this weather in winter or something. And just the whole feel of it is just... wow. And that's been going on every day the same. Every day the same. Not unpleasantly so, because it is the middle of summer. There's just this kind of fresh coolness here. Just fresh coolness here. Just, wow. And yet the crickets or cicadas are still out, just softly chirping, softly chirping. Amazing, amazing, amazing times right now. It's like you say, well, I want to learn how to die. And the Holy Spirit says, okay, that's fine. But I'm going to give you unlimited quantities of time in which to learn how to die. And therefore, where you're at right now, it doesn't seem as if you're making any progress in that direction at all. Or you haven't even, you know, made any progress at all. So, see, but it's not depriving you of your desire. It just adds limitless quantities of time, so you can say, yeah, I still want to die, learn to die, but it you know, I don't yet see the slightest evidence of it anywhere whatsoever, you know, and I probably won't for, I have no idea, but I can't envision ever seeing any evidence of it, even though theoretically, if I continue on with an endless, limitless quantities of time trying to see, eventually I will see, but for right now and the foreseeable future, it's evident that I won't be seeing the slightest evidence of that. So, you see, then that just everything fits like a glove, and you say, wow. Now, yesterday about this time I was taping, and maybe a little later in the evening, actually, and yeah, it was a little later, and I heard this sounds much, and I finally quit the end of the taping, got up, started walking, and I heard clump, 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 and there were deer running down the street, running up the street. They had been down here eating the grapes, eating stuff down here. They'll probably come back. So this new theory, this new way of looking at things, looking at the situation, is I've never looked at it this way before. Never. I always thought the Holy Spirit was trying to get rid of time for us. I said, well, wait a minute. There's another way of looking at it here. Give us endless amounts of time, endless... unbounded quantities of time. So when we don't seem to be making any progress towards dying, we can say, that's okay. Yeah, there's no hurry. We're in no hurry. Let's enjoy this. Now we're not concerned. We're not concerned there's no progress being made because we have unbounded quantities of time to get it done, as it were. Holy Spirit has given us this massive cushion. So we're not concerned that don't seem to be making the slightest bit of progress right now. I said, you know what? The progress may be so slight, there's no way we can see it or be aware of it right now, just because it's going to take so long. So, no worries. It might still be there. Just theoretically, it could be there, just we can't perceive it at all. See? And then where's the concern? Where's the worry? Then you say, This the way I feel and everything reminds me of something. What is that? What is that? It really reminds me. Ah, so lovely, no evidence of death, so stable, etc. Oh, it reminds me of reality. Continuity problem solved. Continuity problem solved. Yeah, just enjoying the evening. Wow, there's some. It's dusk now, and the clouds, the marine layer is coming back in, and we're gonna be covered up heavy with a marine layer. That really just gently dissipates and hardly really leaves so much moisture in the air all day. And we're in the dog days of August here. It's like, wow. What's the climate coming to here? We don't know what it's going to be like, really, do we? So everything can have a depth of time to it, a depth, like an boundless quantity of depth to it, right as it is now. There's some miracle perception the Holy Spirit has for us, that is guaranteed, where we're able to see everything with this, without needing it to be changed at all, or anything other than what it is right now, seems to be right now. And it seems to be as it is right now forever, almost forever, you know. It just, we can't imagine it being some, you know, changing actually. And so there's this constant feeling, I guess would say, of this present in this Holy Spirit's perception. So we will find out about that. Very great. We'll see how it goes. And you know, breakthrough time. August is breakthrough time. There's no question about it. And we just have to get it done. That's all. Just get her done. And it just is what it is. Time to wrap it up. Time to get the breakthrough right now. It is time for boundless quantities of time. It is time for boundless quantities of time. For the expansion of time, as it were, entirely. It is now time for that, actually. Right on time. All right. Very, very great. That's it.